Hello everyone, this is Dr. Ashish Manmani and welcome to chapter number 6, that is Morphological Image Processing. The word morphology denotes a branch of biology which deals with forms and structures of animals and plants. So when we deal with the structures in images, we call it as morphological image processing. This morphological image processing is very much useful to extract the components of image. Okay, and then we use these components to represent image properties or shapes, etc. This is a basic outline of the chapter. So we will initially start with basic concepts that are required in morphology, and then we'll see some basic operations in the morphological image processing. So we'll start with dilation, erosion, opening, closing, and then we'll see a operation called as hit and miss transform. There are many applications, okay, of morphological image processing. Okay, so there are many algorithms that one can use. After that, we will see some basic algorithms like boundary extraction, region filling, thinning, thickening. Okay, as I said, there are many applications. So one can refer to any standard textbook to identify or to study the other algorithms. So let's start with the basic concepts that are required for morphological image processing. Now, in this particular case, we will require some basic concepts of set theory. Of course, you extend them for images over here. So over here, let's consider that we have two sets A and B. So from an image perspective, they are actually two components in an image. Okay, so we can perform the basic operations like union, intersection, complement. Okay, so in this particular case, when I say we have a union of set A and B, okay, it will be represented like this. So for an image, it will be all the pixels which are either part of A or B. Now when I say intersection, okay, so it will be the intersection of set A and B, that is the common portion of set A and set B. So for an image, it will be all the pixels which are common to set A and set B, or we can say component A and component B. Okay. When I say complement, okay, the complement of A, which we denote as A complement, it is all pixels W such that W does not belong to A. Okay, so it is simply the all the pixels which are outside my component A. Okay, and then when we go for difference, okay, we can have A minus B, and that A minus B will be all the pixels W such that W belongs to A but W doesn't belong to B, or we can write it as A intersection B complement. Okay, so it will be only the pixels that are part of A but not part of B. Now, apart from these four basic applications, there are two specific applications related to morphology, that is called as reflection and translation. So when I say reflection, okay, it is the what you can say inversion of the pixel coordinates of a component. So when I say reflection of B, that is B cap, is all the pixels W such that W is equal to minus B, where B belongs to the set B. Okay, so what we actually do is whatever the component that we have, okay, so we fold that component along the origin, along the x axis as well as along the y axis, and then whatever you get, that will be your B cap. Okay, so that is the reflected version of your B along the origin. And then we have a translation. Okay, so when I say translation by amount of z, okay, we denote it as b suffix z or bz, and that is given as all the pixels c such that c is equal to b plus z for all the b belonging to set b. Okay, so over here this z actually can have the x-axis as well as y-axis component. Okay, so x-axis displacement will be denoted as z1, and y-axis displacement will be denoted as z2. That means whatever the origin, okay, that origin will be shifted by amount of z1 and amount of z2. Okay, so amount of z1 along x-axis and amount of z2 along y-axis. Now let's consider an example over here. So there is object B shown over here, and we want to perform the operation of reflection and translation on it. When we perform reflection, we need to first reflect the object along x-axis and then along y-axis. Or we can first reflect it along y-axis and then we can reflect it along x-axis. So over here you can see an example where I am doing a reflection first along y-axis. So whatever the object over here B that we have, I am first reflecting along y-axis, which is the horizontal axis. So I need to mirror it or fold it around y-axis. So when you fold it, you will get an object like this. So whatever object we got now, we will reflect it along x-axis. So we will fold it around the vertical or the x-axis. So we will get the reflected version B cap over here. Now if you see the locations of the points of object B and B cap, okay, you will notice that they are the negative of whatever you have in B. So if you see the first corner pixel over here, that is at the location 1, 1, then the corresponding pixel has gone to location -1, -1. Okay. Similarly, if you see the second pixel over here, that is at the location 3, 2, okay, it has gone to location -3, -2 over here, and so on. Now when we want to translate any object, okay, there will be two parameters in it, that is z1 and z2. Okay, so z is actually made up of two parameters, z1 and z2. So z1 is the shift along x-axis and z2 is a shift along y-axis. Both z1 and z2 can be positive or negative, or they can be even zero. So if it is zero, that means you are not shifting along that particular direction. Okay, so over here let's consider an example where z1 is 1 and z2 is 2. That means along the x-axis or along vertically, I am going to shift by amount 1. Okay, that means I will, whatever object I have or whatever pixel location, each pixel location will shift 1 pixel down or 1 unit down. Okay, similarly over here z2 is 2, so we will be shifting by amount of 2 along y, that is horizontal. Okay, so if you have the value positive, okay, then you shift along the positive axis of x and y. If you have a negative, you will shift along the negative direction. Okay, so here you can see the original object and the object BZ that is shifted by amount 1 and 2 along x and y direction respectively. Now having understood these basic operations, now let's go for the morphological operations. So we will be starting with four basic morphological operations, that is dilation, erosion, opening, closing. And once we've done that, we will go for a specific morphological operation called as hit and miss transform. Now let's see the first operation, that is dilation. Now this operation is mathematically denoted as a plus sign with a circle around it. So we define the dilation of A by structuring element B. So over here A will be always considered as a component and B will be the structuring element. So dilation of A by B is given by all the location Z such that B cap Z intersection A is not a null set. So we can also write this same equation as all the Z such that B cap Z intersection A belongs to, or at least belongs to A. Okay, so if you try to interpret this, okay, it is set of all displacement Z such that B cap, that is the reflected version of structuring element B, and A overlap by at least one point, or you can say one pixel. So if you interpret this operation carefully, then this operation is identical or exactly same as 2D convolution of A with structuring element B. Now let's understand this concept with an example. So let's consider that we have object A of size D cross D. Okay, so it is a kind of we can say a white patch in my image of size D cross D. Okay, now henceforth whenever we talk about morphological image processing, actually we are going to process with binary images. Okay, so whenever I say object, okay, it has the values as ones, and then the remaining or the outside of that object, the values will be zero. Okay, Of course, we can extend it to the actual grayscale images, but that is a later part. Okay, so let's consider that we have an object A over here of size D cross D, so it is all ones inside A. And we have a structuring element B of size D by 4 cross D by 4. Okay, and the exact center is at the center of the structuring element. Okay, so in this case, when we reflect this object B along X and Y direction, you will find that we will get the same object. So hence, in this particular case, my B cap is same as B. For simplicity, again, we are considering that the structuring element B, okay, is all ones inside its boundary. So in this case, it is a square structuring element of size D by 4 cross D by 4. Now, what we are going to do is, we are going to place this structuring element at different positions in an image. Now, wherever there is an overlap of object A and B cap, okay, then we will have a result 1, okay, where my center of B cap is located, okay, in my output image. If there is no overlap between A and B cap, then the corresponding output will be 0 at that particular center location of my B cap. Okay, so it is something like a spatial domain filtering that we are going to carry out. Only thing is, now in this case, we can even place our center outside the object. Okay, it will be still inside the image, but it can also go outside my object. Now let's consider different cases over here. So you can see three different cases I have shown over here. So in the first case, you can see that when I have kept my structuring element B cap, okay, it is completely inside my object. Okay, so obviously there is overlap between my A and B cap. So wherever there is a center location, okay, in my output image, that location will now have the value 1. In the second case, I have placed it in the top left corner. So again, over here, you can see that my object A and B cap are overlapping. So wherever the center is placed, that particular location in the output image will have the value 1. Okay, same will also happen in the third case. Now here, the structuring element B cap is now touching my boundary, right side boundary of the object A. So in all these three cases, we can see that my object and the structuring element are overlapping. Okay, in fact, in this case, there is a complete overlap. Now the output will be 1 for the location where my center of the structuring element B cap, okay, is placed in this particular cases. Okay, and you will find that for all the locations of A, okay, wherever it is completely inside, obviously the value will be 1. Let's consider the cases of partial overlap now. So you can see the three examples of partial overlap over here. In the first case, my center is inside the object A, okay, for the structuring element, and some part of my structuring element is outside the object A. Okay. In the second case, my center of the structuring element B cap is at the top left corner. Okay, so some part is outside of object A and some part is inside. Okay, and in the third case, you can see that my center is now outside the object A. Okay, for the structuring element B cap. Okay, but in all the three cases, you can see that there is a overlap of object A and structuring element B cap. Okay, hence all these three locations, okay, where the centers have been shown, okay, they will obviously have the value as 1 in my output. Now let's consider the cases where my structuring element B cap is totally outside the object A. Okay, so here I have shown three examples. Okay, and in all the three examples, you can clearly see that there is no overlap between object A and my structuring element B cap. Hence, the output will be 0 for all the locations where the corresponding centers of my B cap are lying. Okay, so whenever there is no overlap, as I said, the output will be 0. So how far we can go outside, okay, or what will be the boundary, okay, of my result in this particular case. Now let's consider these different scenarios. Okay, so in the first case, I have kept the object or my bcam such a way that the bottom right pixel of my bcam overlaps with top left pixel of my object A. Okay, so there is only one pixel overlap over here. Okay, now if I move this horizontally, okay, then I can have this second case, okay, where there is a bottom row of my B cap overlaps with top row of A. Okay, and if I continue moving it right, then I will get a case where there is only one pixel overlap, where the overlap will be only for the top right pixel of my A and left bottom pixel of my structure in B cap. Okay, so if we move these two corner conditions downwards, okay, then we can have the overlap of one column. Okay, so it can be the first column of A or the last column of A. Okay, same thing can happen for the bottom row. Okay, so if you position like this and if you trace the what you can say, the locations of the centers, then again you will get a square over here. I have traced these locations of these boundary conditions, okay, and I have shown it over here by dotted red lines over here. So you can see that actually when I find the overlap, okay, my center of the structural element can go outside my object. Okay, that means when I perform the dilation, my output object size will grow. Now before we move further, let me put a quick question for you. So the question is, how much object A will grow in each side when we dilate it with structuring element B? So what you can do is pause this video, think about the answer, write it down, and then you can start this video. Now in this case, we have considered that my object A is of size D cross D and the structuring element B is of size D by 4 cross D by 4. So B cap is also of the same size. Whenever we keep the center inside the object, there will be always an overlap between B cap and A. Hence, all the locations corresponding to A, when I keep the center inside A, I'm always going to get my answer as 1. Now, when I keep my center outside, okay, so you can clearly see that I can go almost half the size of B outside D on any direction. Okay, so if you consider the half size, that becomes D by 8. Okay, so in all directions I can go D by 8 outside my object A. So you can now see the output size. Okay, it will have D by 8 plus D plus D by 8. So that will become D plus D by 4. So that will be total size of the object after dilation. So my output size of the dilated image, that is A dilated B, will be D plus D by 4 cross D plus D by 4. Now let's consider another example. Now here my object A is again a square element that is of size D by D. But the object B or the structure element B is a rectangular one. Here the width is D by 4 like the previous case, but the height in this particular case is D. Okay, and the center is exactly the center of that rectangle. So if you observe, your B is same as B cap. Now when you dilate, okay, my object A is again going to grow in size because of the process of dilation. So how much is the growth? So if you now consider B cap, okay, and from the center if you see, okay, we have D by 2, that is upside my center. So that much it is going to grow on the top of object A. Similarly, we have a length of D by 2 down the center of B dash, which is B cap. So that much it is going to grow down on my object A. If you consider the left side of the center of B cap, then we have a width of D by 8 over there, on the left side of the center of my B cap. So that much it is going to grow on the left side of my object A. And similarly, we have a length of d by 8, okay, on the right side of the center of B cap. So that much it is going to grow on the right side of my object A. Okay. So in this case, my final output will have a width of d by 8 plus d plus d by 8. So that will become d plus d by 4. And the height of the object will comprise of d by 2, d and d by 2. So total length or the height will be, in this particular case, 2d. In both the examples that we have seen so far, actually we are considering the size d or the length d is very large. Okay. Practically, when I say on the top or bottom or the left or right of my center, okay, obviously that center is going to occupy one pixel. Okay. So when I say top, bottom, etc., it will be always one pixel less, okay, that we will have. So just take, whenever we can talk about the size, okay, just take that size with a pinch of salt, that it will be less than one, okay, because of that center is going to occupy one pixel over there. So as we have seen in both the examples, the main operation the dilation is going to do is the expansion of the objects or the components. Okay, so many times it is used to bridge narrow gaps between the objects or the components. Okay, for example, you can see first image over here, which represents a sample of a scanned image. Of course, the scanning resolution is poor, because of which, okay, there are some breaks when you scan these alphabets. So there is a zoomed version of some two alphabets over here, E and A, and you can see that there are some breaks over there. Now, if you feed this kind of image to a case where we're trying to identify the objects automatically, then in that case, we may get some false result, because when you segment these alphabets and when you feed in, okay, it may not get segmented properly. And in that case, it may interpret them as wrong alphabets. So what you can do is, you can use a structuring element, what it is shown over here in the bottom of the image, okay. That is a 3x3 structuring element with a kind of a plus. That means the center is 1 and the 4 neighbors are 1. The diagonal neighbors are 0 in this structuring element. Now, if we dilate this image, input image, with this structuring element, then what it will do is, it will fill the gaps horizontally or vertically by 1 pixel. And when you see the dilated image, you can see that the alphabets are now become thick. And you can see that the narrow gaps or the 1 pixel breaks what we have horizontally or vertically, they all are filled up over here. Okay, so that is how one can use dilation for bridging the gaps. Let's move to the next operation now, that is erosion. Now, erosion is a kind of opposite to dilation. In dilation, the object size was increasing. So in case of erosion, the object size will actually shrink. So mathematically, when you denote, we use a symbol that is a minus sign with a circle around it. Okay, so that is the symbol of erosion. So A, erosion by structuring element B, is given as all the location Z such that BZ belongs to A. Now in this case, note that there is no B cap, it is only B that we are considering. And we are considering BZ, that is a translated version of B. And the translated version of B should belong to A. That means, if you interpret it, it is all the points Z such that B translated by Z is completely contained in A. Okay, so that B should lie, okay, totally inside A. It should not go outside. Let's understand this process of erosion now with an example. So we are considering a same example here with a object of size D cross D, and the structuring element B is of size D by 4 cross D by 4. Both are square elements. So structuring element, when we reflect it, is same as B cap, but actually we don't require B cap over here. So remember that we are always going to take the structuring element B now, not B cap in this particular case. So we will take that structuring element B now, place it at different locations in the image. And whenever there is a complete overlap of B by A, so when I say complete overlap, it means that all the ones of B should be overlapped with ones. Okay, we don't bother about zeros. All the ones of B, okay, should have corresponding ones in the image. Okay, so then in that case we say that the B is totally contained in A. So for all such locations corresponding to the center, the output will have the value as 1. If there is at least one which is not having a corresponding one in A, then the output will automatically become 0. Okay, so all the ones of B should have corresponding one in A, then only it will be totally contained, otherwise not. Okay, so whenever it is contained, the output will be 1. Whenever it is not contained, the output will be 0. So over here I have shown different cases, three different cases where B is totally contained in A. Okay, so there is some case where it is totally inside the image, or we can have some corner or the boundary cases. In all such cases, okay, my output will be 1 corresponding to the center location of B. Now consider that we move the structuring element slightly outside. So in the first case, you can see that my structuring element center is inside the object A, but a part of the structuring element is outside. So hence in this case, my structuring element B will not be totally contained by A. So obviously my output will be 0. Similarly in the second case, okay, so in second case the center is at the top left corner. However, some part of my structuring element has gone outside my part of A. So obviously it is not totally contained by A, and hence my output will be 0. Similarly, the third case, now here the center has gone outside the object. Hence my structuring element B is not totally contained by A. Again, my output is 0. So whenever some part of your structuring element moves outside the object, automatically your output is going to become 0. This means that my output will be 1, okay, maximum up to the case where my structuring element or the boundary of the structuring element is aligned with the boundary of the object, or the corner of the structuring element is aligned with the corner of the object. Okay, so here we have shown different cases where we align the boundary and the corners. And if we trace the center locations, which are shown with the red lines over here, okay, inside these red lines, my output will be always 1, because inside these red lines, my structuring element B will be totally contained by A. If we move outside this red boundary, then some part of my structuring element will go outside the object A, and hence the output will be 0. So this is how the final output of the erosion will look like. You can see that the final eroded output, that is A erode B, has a size less than the object A. Okay, and you can clearly observe that the shrinking has happened in all the sides over here. So how much is actually the shrinking? So you can again use the same analogy as that of your dilation. In case of structuring element B, if you count from the center, so from the center on the top, you have a height of B by 8. So that is how much it has shrunk on the top side of object A. Similarly, from the center, you have a height of D by 8 for the structuring element B. So that much it has shrunk your object A from the bottom when you perform the erosion. From the center, you have a width of D by 8 on the left. So that much it has shrunk your object on the left side. And D by 8 is a width on the right hand side of the center of structuring element B. So that much it has shrunk your object on the right hand side. So in this particular case, since it is symmetric, it has shrunk the object by D by 8 in all the direction. Okay, that is top, bottom, left or right. So my final output, okay, will have a size, okay, that is D minus D by 8, that is on the left, and D by 8, that is on the right. Okay, so it will be d minus 2 times d by 8. So if you find out, that answer will become 3d by 4. Now let's consider the second example where the object A is of size d cross d, but now my structural element has a width of d by 4 and height of d. So you can see that my height of the structuring element is same as the height of my element. That means if I move 1 pixel up or 1 pixel down, my structuring element will automatically go outside the element A. Okay, so we can't have a upward or downward movement. Okay, I can only have my structuring element aligned with A. Okay, for the top and bottom. Now the width is d by 4, so it is going to shrink on the left hand side by amount of d by 8 and right hand side by amount of d by 8. So if you observe the final output in this particular case, when you erode, you will get a single line where your center is aligned, or the where the structuring element B is kept in line with A, aligned with the top line and the bottom line. Okay, and in that particular case you will get a line with a width of 3d by 4. In both the examples, we have seen that the operation of erosion is going to shrink the element. If the structuring element is greater than the size of the object, then that object will be totally removed. So when you consider the applications, it is mainly used to remove the irrelevant information from the image. So here there is an example shown. So first image is the image that we have where there are a lot of squares of different sizes. So the squares are of the size 1 cross 1 or 3 cross 3 or 5 cross 5, 7 cross 7, 9 cross 9 or 15 cross 15. What we are interested in only to identify where my 15 cross 15 squares are in my image. We are not looking for any other squares, okay, less than 15 cross 15. So what we can do is we can erode this image, okay, with a square element of structuring of size 13 cross 13. So there is a square structuring element of size 13 cross 13. So when you perform this operation of erosion, okay, all the squares which are less than 13 cross 13, okay, in my image, okay, they cannot contain this structuring element. So obviously my output will be zero for them. Only the squares with the size 15 cross 15 can totally contain my structure element of size 13 cross 13. The output size of the erosion or the squares that we will get, they will be of the size 3 cross 3. So how we get it? The structuring element is of the size 13 cross 13. So if you remove that center, then on the top we have 6 pixels, on the bottom we have 6 pixels, on the left we have 6 pixels, and on the right we have 6 pixels. So 15 cross 15 object will shrink by amount of 6 from top, bottom, left and right. Okay, so the size after shrinking now will be 3 cross 3. Now what we do is we again dilate this result with a 13 cross 13 object. So when you do the operation of dilation, this 3 cross 3 boxes what I have after erosion will again grow in size, and the size will be restored back to 15 cross 15. So that is how we are removing the irrelevant details, and what we have preserved is only the 15 cross 15 blocks in my original image. This operation of dilation and erosion actually formed the foundation of morphological image processing. And if you observe them closely, then they are kind of complement of each other. In fact, if you consider the set theory, then they are kind of a dual of each other with respect to the set complement and reflection. In fact, we have a kind of a straightforward relationship between the dilation and erosion. So if you consider the operation of erosion, that is A erode with B, and if you take the complement of it, so we have A erode B the whole complement, then that will be same as A complement dilated with B cap. Okay, so that is how both these operations are related to each other.